Okay, this is GLOCOM. Welcome to our lecture series, distinguished lecture. So, my name is Hideyuki Tanaka, professor of our school is graduate school of interdisciplinary information studies. Now, so our school has started a distinguished lecture series of information society infrastructures in February 2017, yeah, this year. And so we have 14 distinct lecture series. So today is the 14th, the final lectures. Yeah, today, so we invite Ms. Caterina, Rindi, for the distinct lecture. And And so today's lecture is co-hosted by two academic societies. The first one is Society of Social Informatics, and the second one is the Japan Association for Social and Economic Systems Studies. Thank you for cooperation academic societies. Now, so, let's start with Caterina. Caterina is a blockchain consultant and educator, and also a director of Corporate Social Responsibility and Impact. So later she will introduce herself. Then so I skip her introduction. But so Caterina speaks four languages and consults internationally and travels frequently between the United States and Europe. So she has speaking events and conferences include South by Southwest and Inside Bitcoin, Stanford University, and other many international conferences. And before starting her talk, so I explain today's time schedule briefly. So first, Caterina will give us her talk for 60 minutes. After that, Professor Soichiro Takagi, he will give us some comments and discussions, and so for 10 or 15 minutes. And after, Caterina replied to this comment and discussion. After that, so the discussion will be open to the public, okay, to the floor. Okay, so maybe so more than 20 minutes key for the discussion. So please participate in our discussion, so please raise your hand, okay? And one more thing I have to say. Thank you for coming. So now let's start with Caterina's talk. So welcome, Caterina.
Hello, and thank you for inviting me to the University of Tokyo to speak to you all. It's an honor to be here, and you're right, I don't travel to Asia very often, so it's a special honor, and I'm pleased to have been invited to such a prestigious university as well. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about blockchain trends and some use case examples. I see that you all have handouts. I imagine that some of the print is very, very small, so hopefully that will be a reference and you'll be able to see things better on the screen up above. So a little bit about my background and how I got to where I am now, which is, as I explained to someone yesterday, not a direct path. It was very much sort of around and around and this way and that way. But my values have been consistent throughout, so the intentions that I had were always consistent through all the different kinds of work that I did, so the work seemed to vary. My background is originally in education. I taught elementary school, and I wrote curriculum, elementary school curriculum, for about 10 years. I also worked in the nonprofit world, and I ran programs and projects that eventually evolved into my interest in peer-to-peer economies and communities. I've always been very interested in local economies and local communities. In the peer-to-peer world, I've been involved with time banking, which is a very old kind of community infrastructure, but it's very supportive of people within a small town or a city. And that led to my involvement with the sharing economy as it was growing in San Francisco. And this was in about 2010 or so. And there were several sharing economy companies that were just starting then. One of them was Uber, another one was Lyft, another one was Airbnb and TaskRabbit. And I was involved with each of these when they were first beginning, including one called Relay Rides. And Relay Rides is it's now called Turo, and it's a car sharing service. Instead of rides, it's actually my car. So I was the first one in San Francisco to be involved in this program. People would come and I would give them the keys to my car, and then they would pay me, they would take the car for a week or a weekend and then bring the car back. And because I was the first one, it was an experiment, of course. Everything, all of this is experiments. And so sometimes the car came back not in very good shape. And sometimes the car came back and they had left a gift inside as an extra thank you, like a bottle of wine. So I had very, very positive experiences. And one time my car didn't come back at all. But it had a sensor. The company had installed like a sensor inside the car so they could track it, and they knew where it was. So they called me and said, "We know where it is, we'll go get it and bring it back to you." Anyway, it was very fun and funny, and it continued to encourage my interest in communities, because with the car sharing, I met more of my neighbors where I lived in my neighborhood, and I got to know them personally. Which was sort of an unexpected side effect. They thought it was just a way to save resources, that person didn't need to buy a car, they could just borrow mine when they needed it, but instead it strengthened the community. And that was particularly appealing to me because of my interest in communities and strengthening communities. So in 2013, I started attending Bitcoin meetups, interested in the peer-to-peer aspect of this technology. And then in 2014, I left San Francisco and I went to Europe. And I traveled around studying the peer-to-peer and sharing economy in various countries in Europe, including attending and presenting at a conference in Paris called WeShare. And then I met some people that were working on a Bitcoin startup called Swarm. One of the founders was American, and the other founder was Belgian. And Swarm was using Bitcoin in an interesting way, specifically crowdfunding. But crowdfunding so that when someone supported a project, they actually became an owner, like a shareholder in the project. And they were doing this using tokens on the Bitcoin blockchain. And so the tokens, we called them Swarm coins. The tokens, the value of the tokens depended completely on how many people were involved, if the project that was being supported was a good project. And it created its own sort of network effect. So the token holders wanted their project to succeed, and so they would help with the project. So we crowdfunded our own company, Swarm, using the technology that we had developed. And we raised $1 million. We launched in Berlin, Germany, and we raised $1 million in Bitcoin. Everyone contributed via Bitcoin. And then everyone that had the Swarm coin, that had contributed money, Bitcoin, and became a shareholder, they also helped us with the company. So they helped with graphic design, or with social media, or with QA testing of the site. So again, it was a very interesting sort of network effect of the more people got involved, the more they wanted to see the project succeed, the more value the token had. And I eventually became the community manager, and we had swarm members or agents, we call them agents, all over the world. We had some in Japan, we had some in China, mostly they were in Europe and in the United States and Canada and in Australia. But we did have swarm coin holders everywhere. And so that continued my interest in Bitcoin and blockchain technology. Unfortunately, in 2014, right after we raised $1 million in Bitcoin, the value of Bitcoin went down because it was quite volatile then, and it's still a little bit volatile. And so our $1 million became $250,000 instead, because we never changed it. We kept it in Bitcoin. So we didn't have very much money, but we lasted about a year and a half, swarmed it. And the founders wanted to come to Silicon Valley to try and raise some actual venture capital as well as the crowdfunding that we had done. And we did not succeed, mainly because it was a legal gray area of what the token was. And it was too risky for people to invest in something that was undefined and unregulated. And now, in 2017, there are many versions of this happening. And in fact, in the United States, there was a federal regulation, it was called the Jobs Act, that had passed and was slowly being implemented, that was allowing non-accredited investors, meaning investors that did not have $1 million or were not financially very secure, to still get involved and invest in companies. So it changed the rules a little bit, allowing more average middle-class people to actually own shares in companies. But that was not enough because we were also working in Bitcoin, which nobody knew what to do with. And still, many people don't know what to do with. It's a confusing cryptocurrency. And in the United States, Bitcoin is treated as a commodity. In other countries, in Japan, in the UK, it's considered money. So the treatment of it is still unclear, and that makes investment for certain aspects of these startups a little risky. So let's see. Forgive me, I have to check my notes. The last part then is that now I continue to do education around Bitcoin and blockchain. The public speaking is that one of the parts that I like the most, but also the opportunity to tell people, to bring more people into the community, if you will, specifically non-technical people, because I feel that this is a technology that has been developed by engineers and computer software developers, and it needs, because of the kind of implications that it will have in the future, it needs also to be influenced and shaped by philosophers and by designers and by artists and by people who don't have access to normal financial systems, because they are some of the ones that can benefit the most. So I feel that my mission now is education and, again, growing this community to have more people involved in the process. Because I've been working with so many big companies as well, I started recognizing the kind of impact that these companies have beyond just their financial investments. And so I've been working with Elephant.ai, which is a machine learning data analysis company. And if you have any interest in this, you can come talk to me later. But I've been working with them on their sustainability and impact, considering environmental, economic, and social issues in running a company. So that means your own employees, that means the local environment of where your office is located, your supply chain for your components, hardware components, things like that. So I have sort of two aspects to the work I'm doing now. And Elephant is not necessarily related to blockchains, but one of the applications of the data analysis is in pricing markets, financial markets. So it's highly likely that Elephant will be using blockchain technology in the future. Again, if you have any questions about that, you can come talk to me later. I won't cover much more about that. So today I'll talk a little bit about general blockchain innovation trends in Silicon Valley and in the US, and then I'll review a few of the interesting areas where blockchain is being adopted and explored. And again, this is not an exhaustive list. This list changes quite a bit because many of these startups don't necessarily succeed, but there's quite a bit of research and exploration and experimentation going on. So to give a picture of where the venture capital money is going and where the less risky or more potentially financially successful investments are being made, they are where in 2016 it was about $496 million, and that's worldwide, that's not just in the US. But the main venture capital firms were in the United States. So Digital Currency Group, based out of New York, was the top one, investing in blockchain technologies. Blockchain Capital in San Francisco, and then Draper Associates in Silicon Valley. And I realized actually that I was going to talk a little bit about what Bitcoin and blockchain is, but I'll save that for when we get into the use case examples. In the US and Silicon Valley, some of the top funded blockchain startups were these five that you see here. And I'm going to go into describing what they are a little bit more. But before I keep going, I want, just with a show of hands, how many people know what Bitcoin is already? Excellent. And when you hear blockchain technology, how many people know what blockchain technology is as well? Okay, fantastic. So that's the majority. I will give a very brief synopsis of it. Bitcoin is now, it's an alternative digital currency. It doesn't exist in any physical form. It's not owned or run by a corporation, by a bank, or by a government. It relies on a completely decentralized network all over the world of users, of nodes, miners, and all of these nodes communicate via consensus. They agree when a transaction is valid. And the technology that Bitcoin uses, which is a currency, has other applications. So when we talk about blockchain, we're just talking about the general technology, like a software program. But Bitcoin is just the first one that we've seen. Now there are others, and each one can do something slightly different. Another very common one is called Ethereum, and Ethereum is also a blockchain with users all over the world, completely decentralized. But rather than focusing on being a currency that people can move around and exchange, Ethereum was built to be able to facilitate contracts and programs so that you could write a program, put it on the blockchain, and that program could then be used by other people. It could be automated to do something when you want it to. And it is all of this is open source, so accessible to everyone to use. The other aspect of the Bitcoin blockchain and of many of these blockchains is that because it is fully networked and connected to everyone, it's visible by everyone. So any transaction or program that you post on this blockchain network can be seen by everyone else. And it is all cryptographically secured, so very secure. And you can't change past transactions. They build on each other, on the Bitcoin blockchain, chronologically, and it is financially very expensive to try and change them and very difficult to try and change them. So basically, once a transaction is posted, it stays there and it's permanent. So when you think about efficiencies around these kinds of financial transactions, it reduces fraud, it is an international network, it makes it easier to move things around more quickly, more securely. And these are the kinds of elements that become important in finance, but in other kinds of transactions and communications. So to come back to the slides, the top funded startups were Circle, that I'll start with. And Circle used to be a Bitcoin wallet, but they pivoted recently. And now they offer global payments using open internet standards and protocols using blockchain. So I used Circle, I had it as a Bitcoin wallet, but now I just have US dollars there. And I used it last week because I have family in Italy and I needed to send some money to my brother. And if I use my bank, a wire transfer through my bank, it will take 4 to 13 days. I will have to pay a fee on my end and he will have to pay a fee on his end. When I used Circle, I put money into my Circle account via my bank, and then I sent it to him, to his email address, and he got a link and a connection, and he had also a Circle account, and he had it instantaneously, and in his wallet, it was euros. So we were able to do this very quickly, and then he could withdraw it into his bank account, or he could withdraw it onto a credit card. So this is a very simple example. And you're going to see these kinds of global payments becoming more and more common and easy to do because of these blockchain technologies. Coinbase is a Bitcoin wallet and Ethereum wallet. Also, that Ethereum was one of the other blockchains that I was describing. Ethereum also has a currency, a token associated with it called Ether. And by the way, the value of Ether is going up because the functionality of the Ethereum blockchain is growing. And so everyone that has invested to support the growth of it is now making some money. So Coinbase is a Bitcoin and Ethereum wallet and an exchange. So you can buy and sell these digital currencies. So if I have Bitcoin or if I have US dollars, I can use Coinbase to buy or sell more Bitcoin or Ethereum, etc. And it has 6.3 million users, so it's a pretty big exchange. Blockstream makes software and hardware using the blockchain platform. They're focusing on cross-chain compatibility using sidechains, and their core software platform is called Elements. It's used by PwC and other partners. So they basically build tools to use on the blockchain, and they're interested in having blockchains be able to speak to each other. So they're building tools in order to facilitate that. Ripple works directly with banks, so they're also doing cross-border payments and global payments, but Ripple is specifically working with established banks, whereas Circle, the example that I gave earlier, just uses whatever the local currency is with the individual. So Ripple offers their services for banks. And at the top of the slides, you'll see that I put the URL, so you have a copy of this and you can look all these up. And for Ripple, these are some of the banks that Ripple is already working with, so you have a sense of how thorough their system, their network is growing. And they are putting quite a bit of emphasis on corporate disbursements and retail remittances. So this is pretty good business for countries where there's a lot of immigrants that are sending money back and forth to their families. 21 Inc. is pretty well known, based out of Silicon Valley. And 21 Inc. makes a Bitcoin computer or a Bitcoin chip that's specifically designed to mine Bitcoin, to create Bitcoins, basically, or unlock Bitcoins is a better way to put it, as the computer runs services. So they encourage open development to create applications, and you buy the specific chip to do it. And so some of the services that they are encouraging people to use are a notary or a translator, so that when you use the service, you actually pay for it, and then the person who created it or who owns the site gets paid for it. It's 21 Inc. is doing some very interesting experiments, but every time I check the website, it looks completely different. So I encourage you to follow and see what they're doing, but I feel like the next time I give a presentation about 21 Inc., I will be describing it differently. So they're doing quite a bit of exploration. For example, this is their current website, and it's promoting paid email messaging. So for example, if I was a very important CEO of a very large company and you wanted to ask me a question, but I don't have time for you because you're just a student at the University of Tokyo, if I set up a profile with 21.com, then you could pay to get access into my mailbox. And then I would answer that question, and the money that you paid would then go to a charity. I think this is working for them, but I have not used the service. Part of the reason I mentioned 21 is because they have, they're the first ones to make a Bitcoin chip specifically for this. So it's interesting what they're doing. I just think they're changing some of their business models as they go. I did want to mention that in Japan, in 2016, there was investment in two companies. One is called BitFlyer. They received $27 million in a Series C round, and Coin, which received $20 million in a Series A round. The number that I showed earlier, that $496 million that were invested in blockchain companies worldwide, that was in the U.S. That was about 50% of that was in the U.S. But in Asia, there is more investment being made now, and they expect that the Asian investments to go up and the U.S. investments to either stay the same or decrease. So it shows that the adoption and the interest in Asia is growing. BitFlyer is a Japanese cryptocurrency exchange, and I think quite a successful one. And then Coin is a Bitcoin trading platform, and it covers all major global and Asian currencies. And I'll mention two more Japanese blockchain businesses. Zaif is also a cryptocurrency exchange. And Orb is a marketplace that uses virtual currency. So this is a slightly different experiment. They're trying to get people on a platform, a marketplace of services and products, and they're trying to sort of keep it a virtual world with tokens. So it's sort of a software as a service company. It's not exactly like the other ones. Here are a few other blockchain-related startups and businesses in Silicon Valley and in the San Francisco Bay Area. And I mentioned these at the talk yesterday, so I'll go into them a little bit more. Bitwage offers international payments and invoices, and they target remote workers and international contractors. They also offer a Zappo credit card and a pooled savings account. And I use Bitwage also in an interesting way. I want to continue to own Bitcoin, but I don't have time to remember to go and buy it on an exchange. So I have Bitwage connected to my salary, and every time I receive my salary, I have a portion of it automatically transferred into Bitcoin, into my Bitcoin account. So they're able to do that. It's like a direct deposit, and they can set that aside for you. So that's kind of cool. That's not advertised right on their page, but I like that as one of their little features that they offer. Bitwage has clients including Google, Facebook, Uber, Airbnb, the United Nations, and the World Health Organization. So they have pretty decent adoption. Hyperledger is an open source collaborative effort created to advance cross-industry blockchain technologies. I'm reading that from the website, in case you couldn't tell. It's a global collaboration, and it's hosted by the Linux Foundation, which means it's all open source, and it includes leaders in finance, banking, Internet of Things, supply chain, manufacturing, technology. So they're building tools to enable more access with different kinds of blockchain experiments. They have a few active frameworks right now called Fabric, Aroha, and Sawtooth Lake. Some of these are distributed ledger technologies, and some of them are blockchain, like plug-and-play tech tools. Interesting to note about Sawtooth Lake is that they're using a proof of elapsed time consensus. If you know a little bit about how Bitcoin works, it uses a proof of work consensus, which is very energy consuming. And so they instead have created this proof of elapsed time consensus to reduce the energy consumption. And I mentioned already, all of this is available, it's all open source and available on GitHub. So that's part of the ethos of blockchain tech, is that it should be transparent and adaptable to people. This is another company based in the Bay Area called Chain. And Chain builds blockchain infrastructure. They specifically build permissioned networks. So when I was describing earlier that Bitcoin and blockchain is a big, the Bitcoin blockchain is a big decentralized open network, many of these companies are instead making similar versions, but they're making them closed permissioned network. By permissioned, I mean that they decide who has access to this blockchain, who has access to the ledger and to the information on the ledger. So Chain is specifically working with permissioned networks, and they move assets around like currencies, securities, derivatives, gift cards, and loyalty points. And they have several good big clients as well, such as Visa, NASDAQ, FinServ, Citigroup, Capital One, Orange, and State Street. Chronicled is another startup that's in the Bay Area, not specifically in fintech. Chronicled tracks physical items on the blockchain. So they, and Dr. Mulligan mentioned this a few days ago, they overlap with Internet of Things as well, and you'll see that a lot of this, there is overlap and in these shared spaces. So Chronicled, the way that Dr. Mulligan mentioned it, is that Chronicled tracks wine, fine wine, to make sure that the wine is, the original wine that's put in the bottle is the wine that ends up with the customer. They also track luxury sneakers. And again, because of the potential for counterfeiting. But one of their use cases that I saw recently was a drone that they have that is registered on the blockchain and is given permissions to go and make deliveries in certain places. So if you have asked for something to be delivered to your house on a certain day at a certain time, then the drone knows to come. And the example that I saw was a video, was that there's a window, you would have like a sensor on your window that would communicate with the drone to give it permission to come into your house. Anyway, it made me laugh. But this is using blockchain technology to register the drone and transactions there. I mentioned Zappo earlier as one of the tools that Bitwage was using. Zappo offers a Bitcoin wallet, cold storage, which is like a very safe account for your Bitcoin, and a Visa debit card that is linked to your Bitcoin wallet. And what's particularly interesting about the debit card is that it can be used anywhere. It's a Visa, anywhere that a Visa credit card can be used, and it is connected to your Bitcoin account. Veeam is another one of these companies that's offering global payments, much like Bitwage and Circle, and Veeam offers global payments in over 60 countries. This is one of the consistent themes that you'll see, is cross-border or global payments for a good application of blockchain technologies. So we've seen a predominance of blockchain focus on finance and infrastructure. platforms. And this is generally where most of the developed work is and most of the financial investment is. But I think it's because of these main qualities that I mentioned, that the blockchain is distributed or decentralized, that there is a consensus mechanism, that it's transparent, immutable, meaning unchangeable, and that it's cryptographically secure. So these are all elements that financial companies are particularly drawn to for the obvious efficiencies. But there's many other applications of the blockchain technology. They're just not all as far along in their development. So I put a couple of different graphics up here from different sites. This one comes from CB Insights. They all organize their graphics slightly differently, but it's just nice to have the visuals up there. So they organize it, this is startups, by the way, in particular, so not existing companies, but startups. So they organize it by the financial services, the digital currencies, some of the software as a service. So, and you can see, because you see the logo on there, then that'll help you search it later. But if you can't see it on your handout, you're welcome to email me later and I can send you some of these names if you couldn't see. I will just cover a few of these in today's lecture, not all of them. We only have an hour. This is another graphic, and unfortunately I don't think you can see this one at all. Again, email me and I can send it to you. The areas that it's grouped in are some of the areas that I will cover today. And then this is the last one, and they organized it. I'm sorry, this one and the previous one were from 2015, so they might be a little bit outdated, but they organized it by financial and non-financial. And I'll cover a few of these companies today as well. So I think that there's several other applications for blockchain technology apart from fintech. And I'm going to give some of the use case examples of these coming up next. And these are based in different parts of the world. PocketDoc is specifically tackling the healthcare industry. In the United States, our healthcare medical records are not all digitized. Some of them are, many of them are still on paper. The communication between hospitals and doctors and insurance is not very well established. And so PocketDoc has been specifically tackling that using blockchain technologies and then also tying it in to patient monitoring and patient data, different ways. So they've built something called DocChain, and it uses a secure network. And DocChain includes medical records, but also wearables. So if you have a Fitbit or something that's tracking your steps and your blood pressure and all of those things, that data is also all addable to this. They also track insurance information. And then if you have, for example, an implant of some sort or a pacemaker, for example, they can track that information as well. They use a secure distributed network that stores the location of the relevant data, and it verifies access to that data. So that can be securely tracked, verified, and shared. And it's also tied in to ID systems. And they have, PocketDoc is pretty well developed and is working with quite a few different healthcare companies in the US. This company, and sorry, to go back to PocketDoc, they're not the only one. They're just the most well-established example. This company, Share and Charge, is working in the Internet of Things space and the energy space and sharing space. And it has been started by the same folks that built Slockit. Slockit was a lock that you could control remotely that was tied to the blockchain. So, for example, if you wanted to share your bicycle and you had a Slockit lock on it, you could rent out your bicycle and all of it was up on the blockchain so that you could do payments as well as give it permission to unlock at a certain time or for a certain person that had this ID. Share and Charge uses the Ethereum blockchain, not the Bitcoin blockchain. And right now, they are sharing or enabling sharing of power for where you plug in your car for electric cars, and parking spots. But they imagine that you could also share the car itself. So the early version of what I was doing with my car, except instead of handing the keys to someone, the car can do it all by itself. And when we think about the future of self-driving cars, this could very well take out the middlemen. Right now, Uber, as an example, because it's worldwide, they have individual drivers. They imagine a future where all the cars are self-driving and they imagine themselves still being in the middle, earning the money from the cars. Tools like Share and Change take out the Uber. They take out the intermediaries completely and they make it the individual owner of the car, me, and then the person who's actually borrowing the car. And blockchain technologies allow that kind of communication and networking. Estonia, the country of Estonia, has a very advanced electronic ID card system that's tied in also to their healthcare system, transit, voting, medical records, and bank accounts. And they've developed a kind of blockchain platform called X-Road that links all of these databases. It's decentralized, it's cryptographically secured, and it's scalable so they can add new services. Estonia has been really on the cutting edge of a lot of this. They also offer an e-resident identity management system that Dr. Mulligan spoke about yesterday. With their e-residency, you can live in another country but have an ID in Estonia, and once you verify who you are, and then run a business in Estonia that would be incorporated there as well, and then would have the tax implications of that country. So if you are in a country where you could not run a business for whatever reason, Estonia offers you an opportunity to do that in their country, all online. Another company doing identity management is BitNation. And I did just want to mention them briefly because they have been trying to target refugees and people for whom having government IDs is either problematic, it's hard to get, or they lose them, don't have access to them, or they are very mobile between countries. There's a few other companies doing this as well. There's one that I did not mention, but email me if you're interested, that offers IDs for women in countries where they are unable to get their own bank accounts. And so if they want to start their own businesses, they can't because they don't have verifiable IDs. But there are blockchain tech options for registering who you are on the blockchain. Everyone can then see it, everyone can then verify it. And BitNation doesn't really believe in country borders, so they have a particular philosophy that emphasizes, as they say, being a world citizen. So it's interesting, the kind of people that are drawn to blockchain technologies is very varied. Some are not interested in being controlled by governments or banks or corporations, but all of them are recognizing the potential of this technology. And I think that it really has a way of connecting us as individuals more, which is part of why I got involved. I only have a few more slides left. Looking at music and art content management, Ascribe lets you confirm your digital creations. post it and link it to the blockchain so that your ownership is confirmed and verified. You can track when that art moves. You can track if that art is bought and sold. And if you share any of that as well. So the next example is Ujo Music and Mycelia for Music. So this was, Mycelia for Music was started by Imogen Heap, who's a singer, and she wanted to find a way to take out the record companies that were making a lot of the money on her music, and she was losing control of her music, and so she wanted to use the blockchain to change that so that she could connect directly with her listeners and that she could also see where her music was going, who was downloading it, and have them pay her directly. And so she did a project with Ujo Music, and they built this this app, which you can't really see, but Tiny Human is one of her songs. On this page, which is a demo, by the way, it's a prototype, on this page, you can download the song. You can see all the people that contributed to it. So the original songwriter, the lyricist, anyone who did the music editing. And then you can pay to use the song. So if you're going to make a movie, for example, and you want to have a soundtrack for it, then you pay something slightly different. And all of this, again, is used, is set up on blockchain. So those are my my general examples around other applications for blockchain tech. Again, just to reiterate, the main emphasis financially right now has been in the fintech space. So the main investment has been in the fintech space and in building the tools, the blockchain platforms and infrastructure. But there are these kinds of projects that are less commodified, less corporate, and are looking at individual control of content and individual control of data. Some of the theoretical uses of individual data around medical records that hasn't been done yet but is being explored is for your medical records and, for example, your genetic information or your health information to be used by pharmaceuticals in their research in developing drugs. And the idea would be that if you control your own information and your own data, then you can give permission for them to use some of it, and then they would actually pay you. So the ability to do small micropayments on the blockchain offers this kind of a potential future. And this is, again, with music, these small micropayments allow for downloads and uses that normally would not be financially viable for a bank. And that is, I think I went through these a little faster than I anticipated, but that is basically my collection of use case examples for today. And I look forward to the synopsis and hearing any questions as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your fascinating lecture. And so, I asked Caterina to introduce the latest movement of blockchain technology, especially focusing on business. Then, so she introduced us many cases. Yeah. Then, so okay. Now, so let's start with Professor Takagi's discussion. So, Caterina, please.
Thank you.
Yes, I have. to win a second.
Thank you very much for having me as a commentator. I'm Soichiro Takagi of GLOCOM, Center for Global Communications at International University of Japan. Actually, I graduated from this school, so it's very, I'm very glad to have the opportunity to speak this session. And briefly introduce myself. I'm actually directing a blockchain economics research lab. It is a combination of the blockchain and also economics. So I'm researching how blockchain technology is affecting the society and economy from mainly social science perspective. So I want to briefly summarize Ms. Rindi's talk and also put some comments which I think is an important point. Her background is from initial background is education. Are you a teacher at the elementary school?
Yes.
Yeah. And so these forms are kind of a general ideas of management community. And she has the early experience on the sharing economy. She raised the case of relay, right, which is power sharing. And I think that she has a general idea of a peer-to-peer and sharing a peer-to-peer kind of culture to provide services and through which the people have benefit by people collaborating with each other without the kind of central intermediary or the management of the people. By big corporations. And the interesting thing is that she also has experience of launching services like Swarm. And also, Swarm was Bitcoin based crowdfunding. And and she is also a community manager from a wide kind of variety of people who are involved in the managing. Blockchain kind of type of business from philosophers, designers, and developers. So she's the best person to discuss on how the innovation in the blockchain field should be conveyed through the wide variety of people. Then she raised many cases on the blockchain businesses. The red part is the companies which I thought is very interesting and important. And what is 21? 21 is, in my understanding, one of the services they're providing is charging money in APIs. So API means a kind of communication between programs. Then they provide some kind of charging mechanism by one call of KPIs. So if the computer communicates with each other, they charge kind of a, not they charge, but the computer charge 0.001 US dollars for one whole KPI, something like that. This kind of technology enables the very micro payments embedded in the computer systems, which is transferred, which enables the transfer of the money in the interaction of the computer systems. This is very interesting. The other one, BitWage, is automatic deposit of money. Because and, there is many coins, from Bitcoins or Ethers or Zcash, but the financial services are still in not fully developed. For example, depositing money or lending money and making a loan to buy a house. Those kind of surrounding financial services are not very much developed yet. So BitWage is kind of a first or very initial case of doing that kind of surrounding services. And she also raised Chronicle, is a blockchain-based service to register physical items, register wines and sneakers, and also similar businesses are coming, like Evaluator is registered diamonds, and we heard yesterday about registered fish on the supply chain management. So initial blockchain was to register coins, but now many kind of goods and digital identities in the blockchain. So this is another point. The next one is Zappo, the Visa debit wallet. It is also very interesting because Bitcoin is becoming very popular, but there's nowhere to use in a daily basis. But this service enables you to use your Bitcoin as long as that store accepts Visa. So many places accept Visa, and you can pay this Visa debit Bitcoin card. And they transfer money from, I don't know, the Bitcoin to the, maybe the fiat money, and then into the retail store. So this kind of service to bridge the real or the conventional business to the Bitcoin makes it very easier to use those kind of new coins. And also share and charge, it is sharing, share and charge enables kind of sharing economy, which sharing economy more decentralized. Suppose that Uber or Airbnb is sharing, but the initial idea of sharing is truly peer-to-peer nature. Okay, I have excessive cars, excessive hub routes, so I can let you to use this. But actually, the Uber itself is a company to manage all of the ecosystems, and they are raising money from the transactions of the peer-to-peer transactions. But using blockchain in the sharing economy makes eliminates the kind of a central intermediary of the kind of sharing economy and enable more kind of ideology of the sharing economy, which is truly peer-to-peer. And BitNation case is, I think it's the most radical. The kind of the nature of the blockchain which eliminates the intermediary to with the trust of information, shows that you don't need a country actually. the kind of a secure information storage can provide some trust on the in terms of the which citizen you are and what right you have and something like that. So this is a kind of a the most advanced or kind of extreme case of using the blockchain, but it shows kind of the extent of the blockchain can achieve. So I want to ask several questions. The first one is, you are a community manager and you are involved working with many kinds of people, I think. But if the people want to start blockchain business, what kind of skills they need? Because blockchain itself is very technically difficult, and engineers who can handle and develop the blockchain kind of technology is very scarce. But also, they need to know very well about financial systems or that what kind of problem is should be solved in the real society. Or in the, taking the example of dictation, in a visionary kind of view on the society would be also important. So kind of what kind of skills is required? This is the first question. And I want to ask the second question on the expectation on Japan. And so the what do you see about the startups in Japan and the student, potential of the students of to become entrepreneurs in Japan. And also, I want to add some points on the Japanese unique background. For example, Japan has a strong manufacturing and automobile industries. So if there is any chance to combine the blockchain with the traditional Japanese industrial strength. And also Japan has a, nowadays, a otaku and manga culture, which could be a very unique position in Japan. So is there any potential to use, combine this characteristic? And the third point is, how can we become a Silicon Valley Japanese or a university of Tokyo student? And how, if some students want to go to Silicon Valley and become a millionaire, and how can they start? And for example, join a meetup or see a venture capital someplace or pitch contests. And I want to answer. Thank you very much.
First of all, I very much appreciate your synopsis. I feel like it has the professor ability to recognize the consistent the trends and the themes and articulate them much better than I can. So thank you very much for that. To your questions then, skills for entrepreneurs in blockchain businesses. So I think there's certainly the programming and software engineering background. And I don't know that, it sort of depends on the business. I think the programming component is very important, but whether you need to have a financial background or not, I think that's part of building a team. So there can be some people that have that additional background, but it also depends on what company you're building. It may not be a fintech company. So that might not necessarily be one of the particular talents that you're looking for. I think there needs to be a flexibility. So an ability to solve problems, but recognize that the problems may change. There's also very much a collaborative spirit, so much of this blockchain technology is open sourced and available on GitHub, for example. So this idea of sharing and being open with your work and also being open to feedback on your work, I feel that that ethos helps entrepreneurs and businesses grow because it means that they can, they don't have to do it by themselves, but they can get people, their peers, to actually help them move their ideas further. A visionary on the team is definitely great. So I've seen quite a few startups that have their original CEO is their visionary, is not necessarily technically inclined, but imagines how they want this this business or this technology to be applied. I find that as startups mature, that CEO then does not usually stay. So the person who has the vision and who has the idea and who starts the company is not necessarily the person who identifies and then drives further the actual business model and business case. So different stages of the companies will need slightly different players. And definitely problem solving and adaptability, recognizing how to solve problems and not necessarily be intimidated when you have a problem in front of you and you think that you have no idea how to solve it. The openness, as I mentioned earlier, to ask for help. In the presentation that I gave yesterday, I talked about the ecosystem in Silicon Valley and in the San Francisco Bay Area. And there are quite a few meetups that are very, very well attended. And I know there are meetups here in Japan as well. The meetups that I'm referring to are around Bitcoin and blockchain and Ethereum and programming and cryptography or cryptocurrencies. And these meetups are used, so they're once a week or once a month, but they're used for people to present their ideas. And it could be a white paper that they're presenting, or it could be a demonstration of a product that they have. And again, it's not, they're not necessarily hiding what they're creating, they're actually putting them out there. There's the risk that someone will steal your idea, but I think that in this environment, that happens less. And instead, people will come in and support and find a way to help you grow your idea. Of course, I'm an optimist, so. That sort of segues into the next question, which is for startups and students in Japan. I think it's the same qualities. There are definitely certain environments and countries, as we talked about yesterday with the EU in comparison to the US, or I should say the UK and Europe in comparison to the US, that some governments and some environments are more regulated. And so that will affect what you can do as a startup and what kind of boundaries you have to work in. Sometimes that regulation is useful. Sometimes it's helpful to know where the edges are of what you're trying to build. And sometimes if your idea is a little bit wacky to start out with, then it's better not to have that. So considering what arena you're entering, that might influence then what country or where you want to do these experiments. I didn't mention any examples of supply chain management, which is a very good application of blockchain, and I apologize, I should have included that in my use case examples. But for a country like Japan, where manufacturing is a big industry, and the auto industry as well, supply chain management is a way to track all of the components that are part of that manufacturing process, all of the ingredients, if you will, and to verify where they go. And my understanding of the systems now is that they can be rather inefficient, there can be opportunities for defective products to get through, or for fake products basically to be added. Even if that's not a problem, then just moving them from one country to the next, or one location to the next, all of that can be quite slow, and each of the points along the way may have their own individual systems. So using blockchain technology for that will help make that significantly more efficient, everyone using the same network, and it can be a closed, permissioned network, or it can be more open. But I think that might be a good application for a country that has a heavy manufacturing or auto industry is the supply chain management. And several of the companies that I mentioned earlier are specifically working on those kinds of applications. And I don't know what to say about the talk of manga culture, except that maybe creativity is always a plus. And there's a place for thinking outside of the box. And then to the last question, though, instead of, you didn't phrase it as how to become a Silicon Valley entrepreneur. I think you said how to move to Silicon Valley and become rich. And I'm the wrong person to ask because I'm not rich. But I think to come to Silicon Valley you have to know that it's an expensive place to live to start out. But I think, again, to come back to this sort of openness and this sharing, this ability to talk about your ideas and to contribute your ideas, I think that that's something that's really useful. And there are incubators and accelerator programs, there's co-working spaces, there's university and industry hackathons that are sponsored. Just get involved, just sort of jump in at any of those opportunities. I think that if someone had looked at my background or pedigree, they would never have predicted that I would have been involved in Bitcoin or blockchain in any way. In fact, I couldn't have predicted it. But I am, and it's because I'm interested. It's because I'm interested and I care about it, and I think that there's some values throughout this technology that are very important that we're going to be using in the future. So whatever your background is, if it's something that you want to do and want to try, I say just try it. You only have failure, right, as your only other option. So I see a question. Yeah. Should I take questions from the audience? Okay.
Yeah, could I get the mic? Thank you.
Hello, hi. My name is Thomas. It's been an honor to listen to you talk, and also being here in Tokyo University with the smartest students that I know in Japan. I am a Canadian venture capitalist, so I'm visiting Japan. And I'm also one of the first seed investors in Blockstream. So if anyone here is very interested in the ecosystem for the startup in Silicon Valley, please come talk to me.
I think you might be a better person to be standing here than me, huh?
Well, anyway, thank you very much.
This lecture by Mita platform.
Oh, right.
So many people. Yeah. Now, so the ecosystem in Tokyo has really changed. Yeah.
That's fantastic.
Okay. So, okay, let's start with the so discussion time. So please raise your hand and tell us your name and this affiliation or organization, company like that. Okay. Any questions? Okay. Yes.
Hi, my name is Ken.
Okay, good.
Hi, my name is Ken Sasaki. I'm also a PwC. I specialize for the fraud detection in financial crimes. And you are one of the examples of the Visa debit card. The strongest reason for using the Bitcoin or the virtual currency system is to prohibit or prevent the fraud? Or are there any other the advantage people want to use the Bitcoin systems rather than going for the regular the Visa transaction, MasterCard transaction systems?
I think that one of the challenges with Bitcoin has been where to use it. If it is a currency, then how can we spend it? And there's adoption, there's greater adoption in some countries than other countries. So the Zappo, the debit card, answers that or serves that purpose to let you actually use your Bitcoin in any country, in any place that you can use a Visa credit card. So that is the advantage. Now, if the question is why to use Bitcoin at all, it is a tool for people that don't necessarily, it can be a tool for people that don't necessarily have access to banks or financial systems because they can transact with this. It's also, you can do very, very small transactions, so microtransactions. I think that for someone like me to use the Zappo credit card, it would be the convenience of traveling to another country and not necessarily having to change money into that local currency, but being able to still tap my Bitcoin account wherever I am.
For those, I can still do with my Visa card. It's not the
There's fees, there's additional fees on your Visa credit card. It would be like using a bank account, so it would be a debit account as opposed to a credit card.
But transferring the real money to the virtual currency also requires fees, isn't it? So you are losing the fees on way with others.
That's true, and I can't off the top of my head quote what the fees are, but traditionally any kind of Bitcoin transaction fees are significantly lower than any kind of bank fees.
To me, it's not enough to shift from the currency to the Bitcoin logical systems unless there's a significant advantage to the society's people. That's the one I was looking for, the paradigm shift.
Yeah, I think maybe another way to think of it is in the case of Greece, where the residents did not have access to their bank accounts for a certain period of time. Or a country that has very high inflation in South America, for example, where the value of their local currency is skyrocketing or decreasing, I should say. So for a country that maybe doesn't have a stable currency at the time or access, this could be another tool. I think that a side case is some people made a lot of money in Bitcoin. They collected quite a bit of Bitcoin years ago, and maybe now they're looking for ways to actually spend it. That was a joke, yes.
I've been in Asia. I don't spend much time in Japan. So I spent a lot of time in China and APAC regions. China's biggest problem is counterfeit the bills. You cannot trust the money they use. So that would be a good way to prevent money into black societies. But again, there has to be motives to people in China to use the Bitcoin systems rather than using the paper-based government, the plate. So what we how can people overcome the obstacles to changing their transaction systems?
I think these are all very good questions. I'm not sure I have the answer for you now. I will say that I like having alternatives. There's also someone.
But could you purchase property by Bitcoin? So instead of converting Bitcoin to local currency, ultimate goal is to having the Bitcoin to transact with the actual goods and services, right? Then you don't have to get charged. Isn't that the purpose of the having or currency Bitcoin?
Yes, definitely. Though he did make a point that when you're using the Zappo debit card, there may be some fees as well. I still think those fees would be less, they'd be much less than what a bank account would be. But I think you make a good point too.
Well, can I continue? I'm from Deloitte actually. Doing taxes for those funds and financial services. And then I was impressed with the big nation. And I ended up Googling Suzanne Temple. And she have to work for U.S. government because it's great to have, all the ladies that can't have a bank account, to have bank account, etc. But also U.S. and then, the OECD employee control system, BACA or CRS, so that terrorists cannot launder money. So using a network of U.S. banking system that can settle international payments, they try to control illegal money movement. And I was wondering, the Suzanne might be a biggest threat for U.S. government. And then it seems like Wikipedia said that she has to work. I mean, she chose to work in U.S. security defense. It makes sense. But also, say oil is all transacted by the U.S. dollars. Now, in Russia, Iran, and China may use Bitcoin Bitcoin or something else for barter exchange, Bitcoin to Bitcoin or property to Bitcoin without dealing with US dollar. That would actually be a threat for US dollar as the main currency of the world. So I thought this big nation is really also audacious, very, very challenging, but also has political implications, and I thought it may government might cue them. I think this was an interesting observation. I want to know more about that.
Yes, I agree, and I met Suzanne Tarnowski-Temboff a few years ago, and I feel she's a very audacious character, but I appreciate having that voice and that perspective as well in there. I think a lot of these kinds of applications of blockchain technology are threatening to current systems, to current financial systems, to current government systems, and if you are a member of those systems, then it's worrisome. But if you think about the billions of people who are not part of the systems, who are either unbanked or underbanked or don't have identifications, that's a population who has not been benefiting from the way things are now. And I think it's fair to talk about audacious ideas that actually will help a larger part of the population. And yes, it is threatening to current existing banks and corporations and governments. It's true.
Yeah, one more comment from Tax Geek. But also, I do appreciate the value changing, exchanging values and goods and service by Bitcoin, because all the government, from a tax point of view, all the government accounts money by their own currency. Therefore, they have to convert everything to their own system, then there are lots of waste of money. The bank charge hefty fees for exchange, and it's so hard to find what kind of value that each subsidiaries of different country added for what, because of the foreign currency exchange. It's so complicated, time consuming waste, and it doesn't really create value itself. So you can get rid of those things and add the value to yourself, to society, to customers.
Please tell us your name.
Ichiro from Deloitte.
Yeah, Deloitte.
Yeah, okay. So last week I went to Netherlands and Delft University with Deloitte. Plus, we visited Deloitte in Haag. Yeah, so
thank you. Anyway, so please.
Hi, thank you. It's a wonderful lecture. My name is Jeff Wonger. I'm a software engineer in Tokyo, and on the cusp of launching a blockchain startup here. I have a question for you about crowdfunding. The sharing economy, you mentioned your involvement with Swarm, and that was a crowdfunding platform that raised $1 million at the time, maybe when society and the laws weren't ready for it yet. And then a couple of years ago, there was the DAO, which raised $150 million. And if society was ready for it at the time, there was a programming error. Essentially, they got robbed of a third of that, of $50 million. My question is, what's next? And what do you think sort of version three of this crowdfunding sharing economy in the blockchain, the Bitcoin world is going to look like? And how do you think something like that could be successful going forward?
Yesterday I talked about initial coin offerings. So ICO is pretty much what the DAO did. And the DAO was an excellent example. And it was also an excellent example of what happens if you don't write your contracts very well. But I think it was an important process to go through, because all of this is so experimental. Of course, I didn't lose as much money as other people did, so it's easier for me to say that. But I think it's going to be continued versions of what the DAO did. So ICOs, initial coin offerings, and when I spoke yesterday, I mentioned that in 2016, 285 million, I'm forgetting how much it was, but it was a little under $300 million were raised through initial coin offerings. That's including the 150 million from the DAO. And it seems to be a trend that's growing, partly because that kind of investment and ownership share is available to average people with small amounts of contributions. And it encourages that network effect that I was mentioning earlier, where people care about the product that they're investing in and then they help support its success as well. So I think we're going to see more of that on the horizon.
Great, thank you.
Comparing the ICO to the conventional venture capital side investment, venture capital investment has a function to kind of educate and support the startups from the very initial stage to IPO stage. But ICO skip those kind of mentoring functions and just put money in the very initial stage to success. So, in other words, they lose the chance to get the kind of mentoring from the VCs. Mm-hmm. So that's a lot of problems. So, and this kind of a lack of the kind of monitoring makes the many scam coins around in ICOs. So there's two potentials. One is democratization of investment. So that anybody can invest in a startup or very initial stage in startups, which has no subs yet, but only coins. That's the idea of the subs. That's a good part, maybe. But the other side, there can be many scams or kind of much more failure with a larger scale, which are many people. So we have to find the right balance to policy, maybe an intervention sometimes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for exciting discussion. My name is Eiji Sasahara. I'm a life science team of Deloitte. And I'm very interested in adoption of blockchain to non-financial industries such as healthcare. And also I'm interested in social impact investment. So from your perspective, do you have any kind of measurement for impact investment to blockchain to social social science or non-commercial area?
I'm not sure I understand your question. It's blockchain investment to social ventures?
Oh, yes, social enterprise management. In my opinion, healthcare.
The social impact ventures?
Yes.
I haven't seen that specifically. There is a nonprofit, a charity right now called BitGive Foundation. And it's purely a charity, it's a Bitcoin charity, so you can make Bitcoin donations and then they fund projects like building wells in certain countries in Africa. And they are building a transparency tool so you can track exactly where and how your donation is used all the way through from the very beginning of your donation to each of the steps that it goes, so you can see when it travels from one country to the next, if it's used to buy tools or equipment, if it's paying for services and things like that. But I haven't specifically seen blockchain applied to social impact ventures.
Thank you.
Okay,
please,
please.
Hi, my name is
I'm impressed with some of the companies that we have in the room. I feel like I should check in with them about my next presentation.
Thank you very much for the lecture. I'm Kensuke, student in this graduate school. Let me ask two questions to you. My first question is, what is your criteria to invest in various projects which seem to use blockchain technologies? And my second question is, if you focus on the blockchain trend in the US, have you ever felt cultural differences between districts? It means the atmosphere in Silicon Valley and that in New York. Yeah.
So when you ask about criteria, you're asking about my personal criteria for investing?
Yes, personal criteria, if possible, please.
So my personal criteria, and I think I've learned this from people around me, and including some of the VC investors that I know, is to look at the team, who's involved in a project, and not necessarily looking at a team and looking at what their, you know, if they have the right pedigree of school that they went to or anything like that, but to see what their experience is. So if they come from different arenas, what have they done in the past? And do they have anything to show, any kind of a portfolio or something to show what they've built or what they have done? Then I think about the project and whether I am moved by the project, not necessarily whether it will impact me directly, but whether it's going to be doing something that's generally positive for the society. I am less interested in extractive projects that are just taking or making money, and I'm more interested in projects that are thinking about their larger impact and sustainability. And then, because I'm not rich, I think about, can I make a small-ish contribution that still is meaningful for them? And I think those are my personal criteria. I think a VC would have others. They're of course interested in the potential success and the exit, but many of the things that I've invested in, I knew that they would fail, or I didn't know. I suspected that they probably would fail, but I wanted to see the team challenged and attempt this project anyway, and so I invested in them. I invested in Ethereum about a year and a half ago, and I own some Ether now, which is worth quite a bit of money, but I wasn't sure that it would. At the time, I'd met Vitalik Buterin, and I'd met some of the other team members, and they're spread all over the world. They're working remotely, but they're all really interested and focused and dedicated on this, and so I was very impressed with the team, and I thought their project had a lot of potential applications, including applications that we couldn't even think of yet. It was a very creative tool, in a way. So that really appealed to me, and so that was a project that I invested in. And then your second question was about the ecosystem in Silicon Valley versus New York. I do think they're different. I can't speak very much to New York, though I have contacts there and friends as well. But I think the city, or the state of New York had quite a bit of financial regulation pressure with the bit license, and that changed some of the tone of the kind of projects and activities that were going on there. I think that there's a big concentration of financial institutions there, and so the kinds of tools that they're building tend to be a little bit more industry-driven, whereas I think some of the experiments in Silicon Valley and the Bay Area are not necessarily there, but I think it might be good to ask a few other people about that. I don't think I'm the best person to compare the two.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, it's me again, Thomas. So I'd like to answer a little bit of your question on what it is the VCs are looking for in basically a new territory. You know, with a new industry, there's a lot of chaos, and you can't really follow a set formula or a certain rule to make your investments in. So in those kind of pioneering days, you know, you can look at the technology itself, you can look at the markets, but it's really the people, the management, that's really going to be the critical key in whether your investments and the company that you invest in, it becomes successful or not. So in my industry, I come up with a saying that you can pivot the technology, you can pivot the industry, you can pivot the markets, but you can't pivot people. So it's people that's the most important. And I also had a quick question for you. I'm unfamiliar with some of the vocabulary, so what you were comparing VCs and ICO. What does ICO stand for?
It's an initial coin offering, which is, for example, startup companies, which is going to start new businesses using blockchain, issue the coins first, then sell it, pre-sale the coin, and they get money, then use that kind of money to create the services afterwards. Yeah.
Thank you. And one, my last comment for the day is, when I came to Japan, I had the fear that the startup industry in Japan is going to be very weak and not really active because of the Japanese mentality of not really being adventurous enough to start companies and being active. But then I learned a thing or two through the presentation that there's quite an active Bitcoin startup companies and the activities there. And I think my pre-connotations were wrong. So I look forward to more interest and active in the startup space for Japan, and also a lot of the active movement from Japan to Silicon Valley, because there's a lot of cross-pollination that can happen in this industry. Thank you.
Several entrepreneurs in Tokyo. Yeah, I know some of them. Yeah, so I don't think so. Japan is in Tokyo. It's not so. I think it changes and become active. Yeah. So in this university, we have one building for startups. Yeah, we stimulate students to become a startup to start up their business. Yeah. Now, so I hope. Yeah.
That atmosphere change. Okay, so let me make a small joke. I don't have an answer, but somehow blockchain or Bitcoin kind of business is very active in Japan. I don't know why, but several years ago there was a outbox.
Yep. Very famous.
Here we are. And I don't know if Satoshi Nakamoto is Japanese, but maybe he's not. But, yes, and many kind of banking corporations are working with startups to transform their business. So I don't know why, but surprisingly, it's very active. Yeah.
Okay. My name is Ping, I'm from Tokyo. So Mr. Kanarina introduced us to international transaction service in your talk. I think it will be very useful because the transaction fee is really low and the speed is really high. So I think one challenge is that for both user and the transaction company to prove that the money, because my money is from salary, not from prima, and I'm not devoted to some terrorist company or some terrorist organization, and I'm not buying some drugs and weapons. So how to self-prove yourself? So because when you start a company, you need to under the monitor of the government. From your experience, how to do some self-proving?
So are you asking if these cryptocurrencies are used for illegal purposes more than legal purposes? I think Dr. Mulligan talked about this yesterday, but the research that has been done has shown that the currency most often used for illegal transactions is cash in whatever country is the local cash, because it's untraceable. And cryptocurrencies are pseudonymous. They can be made more anonymous, but they're still traceable. So they are used, obviously, because black markets exist in every country in every way. But cash is still the primary currency used for illegal transactions. And so now I think it's a reputation thing. So Bitcoin does have, or cryptocurrencies have this reputation for some people, but that's not the predominant use. In fact, the greatest use for Bitcoin right now is exchanges, is speculation, is people speculating on the price going up and down.
But for example, if you use cash, you need at least a system cash to carry cash. But if you use the coins, you just use one button. You place the one button and the money is transferred.
I'm not sure I understand, I'm sorry.
So I mean, if you said if you use crypto, you use cash. But at least you need to...
For electronic transactions, you mean?
You use cash for criminal transactions. But at least you need some soft cash to carry cash. But if you use some Bitcoins, you just send some numbers
right,
to the
right.
Address.
So, some international or faraway kinds of transactions. It's true. It's true. I think it is a tool for that. I think it's. I mean, if you really want to get into criminal enterprises and how those transactions are done, we can talk about the Panama Papers. We can talk about people hiding money and not paying taxes, and you know, a whole different level of criminal transactions that are done within the system that appear to be legal, that are all done electronically. I mean, to your point, yes, it is a tool for doing criminal transactions.
Yes, for example, you use Japanese yen to buy some bitcoins, and then you transfer the bitcoins to US, and then you sell the bitcoins for a lot of money. How do you prove that your money is legal?
How do I make that money legal?
Yes, how do you prove your money is legal? Because it seems some money is fallen from the heaven.
I think maybe you should come and talk to me afterwards about this. But generally, Bitcoin movement, you can see where the coins go. It's all visible and it's all transparent. And as I mentioned, there's ways to sort of hide that a little bit. But if you're asking me how to take illegal Bitcoin and launder it and make it legal, this seems like a conversation we should not be having that's recorded.
I think it's difficult to distinguish legal or illegal, even in yen or anyway, so, okay, this is another question. Are there any questions? Okay.
To answer his question, I can talk for you. I do the anti-money laundering detections. I can do the fraud detections. So that's what we are doing as the top line of the fraud detections and crime prevention. Next question to Takagi-san. People with the virtual coin, it's still possible to cheat, is it?
What do you mean?
Cheating, let's say, illegal transaction or overseas transactions. So, see the banks is also using some of the services to do the wire transfers, which has the feature, the tracing of the past transactions to identify the genuine transaction or the fake or the illegal transactions. But even with the virtual consistent blockchain systems, if I'm smart enough, I can still cheat going under the system to fake the transaction, then get wired to the, say, outside the cell phone. Is it possible?
In terms of, there's maybe the two layers of the kind of transaction. Just blockchain enables that asset is used only once for the payment, and the payment is completed. From one address to the other address. But it doesn't ensure who is behind this transaction. So it doesn't secure that the counterpart is the right person, or this transaction is illegal or legal. It's kind of out of the control of the blockchain. And so this should be solved in the next phase, but generally blockchain doesn't care about the conflict of the transaction. Am I answering to your question?
Yes, I thought so. So that goes to the machine learning techniques to identify the flawed transaction. So as long as that is going on, I guess I can keep my job.
Any other question? Especially from the students? Yeah, today, no students are so active, but yeah, I hope. Yeah. Not only in our school, but the other universities are fine. Please, raise your hand.
I want to go back to the original question that
pressure from the competition between the fiat currency to the virtual currency. And some countries, some central banks, are considering to issue their own cryptocurrencies to provide the currencies which is much more convenient to use and low transactions cost to compete with Bitcoin-like things. So in that case, I don't know if this kind of effort can really be competitive against to the private sector's private currency. There is that kind of initiatives. For in England and Sweden, or reports in China. So, yeah, so sorry. Yeah.
Okay. So economist Hayek, so he proposed non-fiat money, so plural, so he said that so there must be, so plural money must exist, coexist in one area, even in one country. Yeah, and so I think so. So regarding to his, based on his argument, so plural money compete each other. And so consumer where people can select yeah which money is suitable for this transaction. Yeah, we can there are many choices. Yeah. So he said that we should have choices. Yeah. And so one of the students, Igarashi-kun, yeah, he's from ICE area. And so now his university and our university and Takagi-san's university, we cooperate to issue new digital money. Yeah. Now so his university last week so your university issued digital currency in so can you explain that
yeah. I don't have
an
iPhone.
Ah, you don't have iPhone, yeah. Is this guy? Yeah. Okay, so anyway in older days, so regional money is currency. Yeah, it is based on focus on only one area, and so they produce something and they do consume them in one area. But now, so the local currency is produced for these transactions. But the ICE case is different, totally different. Yeah, they aim to. Be a global currency. Yeah. Anyway, I think so. Plural or so choices of money is so important. Okay. Go back to the Q&A discussion. Okay, are there any questions? Not only the student, but also the different participants. Okay.
Hi, I'm John. I wish I could say I'm a student from some reputable university, but I'm not. But I'm interested in Bitcoin and the technology, so that's why I'm here. I think we are at an interesting stage in time, somewhat comparable to when home computing was starting. So I think there's a lot of things we can do. And because this is sort of new, I think, and a lot of different people from different backgrounds can come in, and I guess that's one reason why it's interesting. And I think the number of people who are smart people are getting there are a lot of smart people now, and maybe Bitcoin and the technology behind it, maybe blockchain, is a kind of catalyst. For to get all these smart people to work together somehow, and make some change that we want to see, because there's a lot of things that's not working properly, I think. So I'm interested to hear about how you start building communities, and I'm interested to hear your experience in getting something like. Did you say Swarm started? And because I see it as a catch 22 kind of thing. Like, I have an idea, I want to do something, but I need to get people. And sometimes it's not easy because I don't have anything to show them. And I don't know what's enough. How much do I need to do to convince people? And it's like, you know, it's like once you have people joining, then it's easy. But if you don't have anything, what do you do? You're like stuck. You can't do anything.
I think that's the same with investment. I think getting the first person to invest in a company, and maybe Tom can speak, that's the hardest. And once the first one is in, then everyone else will come. It's true.
So can you talk a bit more about, is Swarm still around? Is it?
One of the founders is still working on sort of the next iteration of what Swarm could be. When I think about building community and I think about how to get people involved, one of the best tools that I had was to find out what people were good at, because everyone is good at something. And it could be something very simple, it could be something more complicated, but everyone is good at something. And some, even if they don't have something they're particularly good at, they have something they're excited about. And when you're excited and interested about something, you become good at it because you're motivated to continue to work on it. So when I was the community manager for Swarm, anyone that came and joined our forum or joined our Slack communication team, I would ask them, what are you good at and what do you like to do? And then they had a voice first. They had then an opportunity to apply those things. And it was pretty successful. And we built a community of people who really wanted to be there and recognized that everyone had something to contribute, even if it was small. When I think about the time sharing, which is something I mentioned earlier, that's not blockchain related, but it's part of these peer-to-peer economies. Time banking uses the premise that, again, everyone has something to offer. So original time banks are usually local small towns, and you contribute your time, your service, whatever it may be, and maybe you can cook meals for people, or maybe you can dig a hole, or maybe you can do translations, whatever it is. And you contribute your service, and that is worth an hour or 2 hours. And you are paid in just time in that way. So you then have that hour or 2 hours, and then I want someone to help me maybe hang artwork in my house. I'm not sure how to secure it on the walls. So then I pay someone who knows how to do that. Or I want to get a massage, and so I pay someone with my time for the massage. And so it builds this community again where everyone has something to contribute. With the internet now, there's actual online time banks. One of them is called Time Republic with a K, and they are time banking with digital services. So it's translation, it's graphic design, it's legal advice, it's social media assistance. I was doing an exchange with a woman in Brazil who wanted to learn English, and so we would get on Skype and talk for half an hour once a week, and then she would pay me a half an hour, and I banked my time that way. So it's a very nice way, again, to connect with people everywhere, but to recognize that everyone has something to contribute. And I think that simple things like this will help you build, as an individual, a portfolio, if you will, and a network.
Thank you for your speech. My name is Min, I'm from NTT. And my question is about the blockchain. So my first question is about how can we develop our own applications based on the blockchain? And so we are facing a problem like which platform we can choose. So we know there are so many open source products, some names like Fabric or even the Ethereum. So my question is about in the US or in Europe, is there some preference that people prefer this one or that one? Or if it is, there is, so what's the reason? And my second question is about the vulnerability in those all access platforms. So in your speech, you mentioned the repo, which is widely used in the financial industry. But there recently, there is also some reports about the evaluation on the vulnerability, including repo. And it is the report is that the repo has the highest risk in aspect of the vulnerability. So as a VC investor, so when you decide which product you want to invest in, so do you consider also consider about the product itself, including the quality, the vulnerability, except for the business model? Yes, thank you.
I think to the first part of your question, you have to figure out what your problem is, what is the problem or what is the thing that you're trying to create, and then determine which tools work best for that. So the Bitcoin blockchain is useful for some things, Ethereum blockchain is useful for other things, Hyperledger and the Fabric are specifically built for other applications. So I think that's the best way, is to figure out what exactly are you trying to solve and which tool then to use. And then as to the where to locate, there are definitely a few places now around the world that have a concentration of developers and of creative talent, and that are easier places to live. Berlin is an example. It's a little bit more affordable to live there. There's quite a bit of a draw and a support structure for startups and collaboration there. Silicon Valley has it, but it's very expensive. If you're working in finance, London, the government there and the kinds of accelerator programs there are very open to blockchain development. So each of these places have sort of their own flavor of it. Personally, I think that you don't all have to be in one place. I think that that's one of the advantages now, that people can work remotely and contribute, and they can be in different locations. And then considering vulnerability, certainly, depending on what your project is, you have to look at the tools and figure out how well developed they are, how many other partners are using those tools. Those are all very valid, important questions to ask.
Thank you. Are there any questions? I'm sorry, it's time to end. But if only one question here. Okay, no questions. This student.
I'm Yulia Chipi, I'm a student from this university, I'm studying here. And I'm pretty interested in supply chain. And unfortunately, sir, you don't have much example to me for supply chain management. So it would be great if you give me a little bit possibility, potential for supply chain management and obstacles to use blockchain technology for supply chain management. And the day before yesterday, Professor Tanaka and Professor Takagi talked about that, and they said changing units. For example, there is a 1 gallon of wine, or there is a 1 bottle of wine, and there are other people say there is a wine for one person and one region. Wine for one region, so it's very difficult to convert units. And I also feel like if you want to reach out like food ingredients, you have to introduce blockchain management to agricultural farmer, every agricultural farmer. And I feel like it's really difficult compared to introducing blockchain technology to manufacturers, because I feel like there are less incentive for farmers to introduce those technologies. So what do you think about it? Please give me some obstacles and possibility for supply chain management.
Do you want to answer any of the supply chain stuff? I can speak to it over here.
I think I can give you some names. If you email me, I can give you some names of some companies that are working specifically on supply chain management. I know IBM has been building tools for this in the US. And some of the examples around tracking items, one of the companies actually that was mentioned was tracking diamonds. And starting with identifying whether the diamonds were mined in a way that was fair to the workers. So once you verify whether that diamond is a blood diamond or not a blood diamond, ideally, then it can be engraved, marked, and then linked to the blockchain. And the movement of the diamond from where it's originally mined to the country, to all the different hands that it moves through as it's assessed, as it's shaped. I think this is just another simple example of it. There's then larger supply chain management that is tied in with sort of the Internet of Things with tracking devices that also can track things like temperature changes. If you're moving food, for example, that can track whether the food will spoil based on the additional information that's on there. So there's having all of that information all on one network that everyone can see is significantly more efficient than how the systems are now. I'm not sure I remember the second half of your question, sorry.
My second question, I mean, I also feel like there is another obstacle, like if you
are... Oh, the farmers, the agricultural, yes. I think it depends on the size of the farms right now, because my understanding of agriculture is that farmers have been using quite a bit of data and using information about their crops and having this tied into sort of larger data analysis a lot more. But I'm talking about bigger farms. So maybe smaller farms, you're right, the adoption of technology would be different. But I was just reading an article about farmers that are using tractors that have computers, built-in computers, and when they buy the tractor from the company, they are told that they cannot change any of the computer settings, or otherwise they will break the warranty. But they want to be able to adjust the computer settings to make the tractor more efficient, or if the tractor breaks down, they want to be able to do the repairs themselves. And these tractors can be remote enabled, so there's already this unexpected sort of use of technology that's happening in agriculture that farmers are having to use both, you know, cloud services and their own equipment in ways that it's not just the physical farming anymore. So I think depending on the size of the farm, we actually do have an agricultural system that's much more tech enabled than we think they are.
Thank you very much. And so I appreciate all of you to participate so actively. So thank you very much. And of course, Caterina, thank you for giving us a lecture. Possible, so please give us final message. What do you have? No?
I'm just very pleased to be here. Thank you. And I don't think I put it there, but if anyone needs my contact information, I can give you a card, and you're all welcome to email me afterwards.
So,
happy if you are starting some new business, and to get contact to with you in the department, or show some good news from Japan.
Thank you, Caterina, Takagi. Thank you so much. So finally, so I would ask you, would like to ask you to fill out the comment sheet and submit to the reception. アンケートシートに記入をして返してみてください。大変貴重なデータになります。それで少しずつ改善をしていって次につなげたいと思います。本当に皆さん、今日どうもありがとうございました。
Thank you.